Well, welcome, and to probably the last Japan Society lecture this side of 2021. My name is Heidi Potter, and together with my colleagues Kyoko and Alejandra, I look after the Japan Society events program. And this is a lecture that we originally scheduled for March, but postponed a few days before the country locked down. We would otherwise have been meeting in March at the Swedenborg Hall in central London, but it's a real pleasure to have everybody here on Zoom this evening. And we're thrilled and very pleased to welcome today Till Weingärtner, who is lecturer in contemporary East Asian studies and director of the Center for Advanced Studies in Languages and Cultures at University College in Cork. Prior to taking up this post in 2015, he taught at the University of Manchester for 18 months and Freie Universität Berlin for 5 years. Since his student days, Till's research has primarily focused on Japanese comedy. During his postgraduate research at Kansai University in Osaka, he tried his hand at stand-up comedy, even winning an award and hosting a local radio show with his Japanese comedy partner. These experiences in the Japanese entertainment industry had a big impact on his research, and he remains interested in performance not only from an academic position, but also by organizing performances for Japanese artists, as well as at times still performing himself in Japanese, German, and English. Though I'm guessing not many performances took place in 2020 even. Till has published 2 books on Japanese comedy, both in German, and is working on an English book on the same subject. He's also published many journal articles on aspects of Japanese comedy, including rakugo and comedy duos. Today, he's going to talk about the role of the comedian in Japan, and particularly how their images are constructed and how they present their persona. After the talk, Till has kindly agreed to take questions. You can post your questions in the chat at any point or ask them yourself at the end. During Till's presentation, I'd be grateful if you'd keep your microphones on mute though, to avoid any feedback or disturbance. So now it's my great pleasure to formally welcome Dr. Till Weingärtner and invite him to speak. And I think you're going to share your screen, Till. So over to you now.
Thank you very much for the lovely introduction. So I hope you can see my screen now. It's being shared.
Perfect.
Mm-hmm. So perfect. Yes, so as Heidi was just saying, we were planning to give this talk in March, and then we literally decided, I think, 3 days or over the weekend to not go ahead. And I think in hindsight, we were actually talking about this yesterday. In hindsight, we were saying, actually, we were quite, before we make the right decision, we would have been very worried if we had asked anyone to come in March. The other positive side effect maybe is that actually the book I'm going to talk about, some parts, Spark by Matayoshi Naoki, has in the meantime appeared in English translation, and maybe some of you are aware of it or have even already read it or might be interested in reading it after today's talk. Because this is the man I'm quite interested in, and to whom I will come back again and again in the talk. This is the author Matayoshi Naoki, who was awarded the Akutagawa Prize for this novel, Hibana or Sparks. And many of you will know that, of course, the Akutagawa Prize is very prestigious. It's sort of the best prize Japan you can get as a newcomer author, but it is also an award that is given for Junbungaku serious literature. And indeed, it was the first time ever that a comedian would be awarded this prize. And of course, that, excuse the pun, sparked a lot of, you know, discussion and interest. And the book turned out to be a huge bestseller, and of course was then adapted for the stage for Netflix. So it's available in every country in the world where we have Netflix. And there was also another film version, and it continues to be something of a phenomenon. So Matayoshi is a manzai comedian, and I think many of you know or will have an idea what manzai is. If not, just very briefly, you could think of manzai as being duo stand-up comedy or team stand-up comedy. So you have two comedians, mostly men. There are a few women, and I've also written about female comedians, but I think it's safe to say 95% of these duos are just men. Normally we have a boke and a tsukomi, so a foolish man and a straight man, and they engage in some kind of on-stage dialogue. Traditionally, this sort of really reaches back to older forms of rituals and performance, even to the Edo period and even earlier. And in terms of genre development, I think it's safe to say that there's more overlap now, that even though someone might formerly be doing manzai, they might sort of switch over into sketch comedy and just use sort of manzai as their framing vehicle here. Now, what I'm quite interested in is indeed that from old times, comedians were kind of, they sort of had a negative image. So many of these comedians in the Edo period would basically be, traveling outcasts, and, they would be welcome to do the ritual, but then afterwards, please do move on after you've made this laugh. The traveling folk, of course, in many countries, this was the case. And this continues sort of to be the case in 20th century. So Tsurumi Shunsuke, who's a famous culture historian and quite a left-wing historian in that sense, he's really interested sort of in the class aspect of manzai. And he wrote that when he was a young man and he went to see a manzai duos on the stage, he was always kind of fascinated that they sort of reeked of being outsiders, and they didn't manage to be, they had kind of failed their expectations. So they weren't able to get a proper job or to contribute in any way to any national effort of such. But they would kind of use that image in a sort of interesting way and would still make it fun to watch. And this sort of caught his interest initially. Manzai Du, which I love a lot, and I've actually this the first book I wrote about in Germany, are these two guys. He is Yumeji Itoshi and Kimi Koishi. And they are also interesting in this context, because there's when you read about their life, and of course they're very much loved and admired and maybe even respected today. But in sort of a heartbreaking episode, Yumeji Itoshi once told on the television was that when he was traveling around with his family, he often, he was always afraid that his own daughter might get bullied in school just because her father is a manzai comedian, because she himself as a child would experience that, being bullied by other children. So, they might love comedy, but they don't necessarily love the comedian. And Yumeji Itoshi is interesting if you are interested in Spark, and if you read the book, or if you read the translation, or if you watch the Netflix show, indeed, then Itoshi Koishi also play a role there, and I'll come back to that. And this image of sort of saying, comedians are, you like to watch them on the TV, but you wouldn't maybe necessarily, want them in your family or among your friends, is kind of still going on, although I think the industry is sort of trying to create a cleaner image. But there still seems to be connection with the shady world, and we get these scandals, basically, where famous comedians, where news find out that they had contact with gangsters and with Yakuza. And in worst case, someone like Shimada Shinsuke on the left, if any of you spent some time in Japan 10 years ago, and just turning on the television, Shimada Shinsuke was on the television all the time. I mean, he was... I sometimes thought he must have clones of himself. He can't possibly be on that many TV shows at the same time, but he just was. And then from one day to the other, he had to retire because he was keeping friendships with some local Yakuza. And only recently last year, that was the case, where some comedians from Yoshimoto Kogyo, including Miyazaki Hiroyuki, would get paid from Yakuza to just perform comedy at their parties or at their gatherings. And then he didn't have to retire, but he was kind of punished by his agency. So he sort of had to withdraw for a few weeks, or he had to pay a fee or something like that. We're talking about changing image. See, there's an N missing there, but it's not changing image, it's changing images. Apologies for that. And I think the image is really sort of changing little by little. from the 1980s onwards, with sort of a tendency that comedians sort of talk more about themselves on stage. Japanese authors like to use the English word real for it, because they don't really have a word to describe it. So if you use a foreign word, maybe then it's something new. So liaru, they would say. And so some kind of references in the manzai act. So for example, Yokoyama Yasushi Nishikawa Kiyoshi, again, being a comedy duo, quite open for scandals, with Yokoyama Yasushi often getting into fist fights with taxi drivers and things like that. They would sort of use that then in their material, that they would sort of say, oh, what is it like when you ride a taxi, and why are the taxi drivers afraid of you? We see also that comedy at that time gets more professionalized in a way. So in the past, if you wanted to become a manzai comedian, you probably would have to, you know, ask an older manzai comedian, say, please train me, you know, please teach me how to do this. But from the 1980s onwards, we have comedy schools where you pay a fee, and then you have some kind of curriculum. So it's more professionalized in a way. And overall, we get more insights sort of behind the curtains. We get more idea what is actually happening in a comedian's life. And what does it mean to be a comedian? What makes a professional? And we do have boom in the popularity of comedians. And we sort of have waves. There was sort of manzai boom in the 1980s. There was sort of another popularity boom in the 1990s. But then at the beginning of the 21st century, we really have a huge comedy boom in Japan. It's called the owarai boom, which doesn't just mean that comedians are popular on television, but suddenly we have a lot of young people who suddenly want to become comedians and think, you know, this is actually a career option that's, you know, respectable and that, you know, will be good for me. I don't necessarily want to work for, you know, I don't want to become a salaryman, but even being a comedian is respectful and it's really something I could dedicate my life to. This popularity sort of spans all across the media. And of course, this is something where I think the industry is really interested to sort of have, you know, the faces of the comedians all over the place. So we have, of course, popularity of comedy as performed in the theaters and of course on television, but we have much more focus even now on individual comedians, and we learn more about their lives, what they're like, what they do. We have comedy magazines like this one here, Warai Typhoon, which, you know, basically also introduces comedians as style icons, or it's to, you know, tell you which kind of restaurants they like to go to, or what their favorite sweets are, these kinds of things. And we get interviews with them where they actually talk about, you know, why do they want to be a comedian? What does this dream of becoming, you know, successful with comedy, and what do they love about comedy? This is sort of always discussed more and more on stage and outside of the stage. And of course, it turns into huge business. So comedians are, you know, subjects or authors or producers or involved in television programs, in film, in manga, internet streaming, of course, 2020, a big thing. It's still interesting to see how this kind of impact that might have had on the comedy industry. And these comedy schools also become bigger and bigger. And now this, if you want to go to the popular schools, you really have to go and audition for a place to even, you know, to be allowed to pay several thousand pounds for a year's course to be taught by a company like Yoshinokogyo. We have then sort of following up on that, something which a comedy critic Larry Toda again called a boom in 2018. Just a boom of books that have been, you know, written about or written by comedians. A comedy agency like Yoshimoto Kogyo, which is this huge comedy producing agency in Japan, in Osaka, they set up their own publishing company, Yoshimoto Books. And when you go to their homepage, you see there will be 78 books listed. And of course, that's again great for Yoshimoto, because they can sort of, you know, they are not paying another publisher to publish books by their own comedians. So they're earning, of course, through the book sales, but they also will get some of the royalties as the agencies representing these comedians who are writing here. And we get more insight into, you know, the comedian's life through certain types of TV shows. Most prominent, probably the M1 Grand Prix, a show which started around 2001, I think. And you can kind of think of this as being something like the X Factor or the Strictly Come Dancing for comedians. So ultimately, it's a contest, it's a competition. It's only the final that is being streamed at the end of the year, and all the heats and the semifinals running much more out of the sight of the audiences. But I'm very fascinated what this show actually did. And what it did, of course, it told the background stories of the comedians that are involved, their little sort of clips that are being played, which introduce the comedians, and, you know, then their interviews and experts and, you know, judges, the whole business. And of course, a show like this creates just a new narrative. And by watching the M1 Grand Prix, of course you want to be entertained, of course you want to laugh, of course you want to enjoy the comedy, but you're sort of more watching it for the excitement, you know, for the question who's going to win, and, you know, somebody going to forget their texts, and you know, are the judges going to be fair, or, you know, will they upset me, and all of that. And with these little clips that sort of introduce the comedians also sort of get the opportunity to sort of then again use the material to make references again to their comedy career or to their own lives. And I would like to share one of these very short clips from with you from the M1 Grand Prix. So I'll stop sharing this now. And I will share my media plan. Okay, share computer sound as well. Okay, and I've actually preloaded the wrong clip, so I just quickly have to load another clip here. Okay, so this is a short clip which would be played in the M1 Grand Prix just before the comedians go on stage. We're not going to watch them now. And, you know, after watching this, you can't stop just thinking, oh my God, how are they going to do? And if they're not going to be successful with that, you know, are they going to mess up? And will they ever be able to go back to comedy or not? And it just creates so much excitement. And I think this duo here is interesting because to some degree, they're introduced as being not very successful, getting no fan letters, never reaching the final of the M1 Grand Prix. And then really thinking about, you know, maybe comedy isn't for us. Maybe we aren't successful enough. Maybe we have to stop. So it becomes very clear comedy is, as the title of the talk says, it's no laughing matter, it's hard competition. And it really gets to you, because if you are not successful, it's just not fun, actually, despite looking quite fun. Three bestsellers have been written about, I think there were other bestsellers as well, but I want to talk about three best-selling books written by comedians briefly in the 21st century. Tamura Hiroshi, The Homeless Junior High School Student from 2007. I'll talk about that in some detail. I'll very briefly talk about Shinagawa Hiroshi's Manzai Gang, and then indeed Matayoshi Naoki's Hibana from 2015. And all of these books have autobiographic elements to some degree. So we have characters or narrators that are or that are going to be comedians. So to some degree, they all cover the life of the comedians in different kind of detail. And they're all so successful that they all sort of had different types of adaptations and spin-offs even. So, for example, Homeless Chugakse, you know, was turned into a manga, and Hibana was turned into the Netflix series. So, also from an economic point of view, or from media marketing point of view, they were all very interesting indeed. So, Homeless Chugakse, the homeless junior high school student, was a book written by the comedian Tamura Hiroshi, and it wasn't really much about his life as a comedian, but it was sort of his life before becoming a comedian, his life as a junior high school student, as a young boy, and about his experience of being homeless for a while, basically because his father obviously made so much debts that the family was thrown out of their flat, and then the father just left and left the children deal with the problems for themselves. This is something which has kind of caught the interest of some Japanese studies colleagues who are interested indeed in the cross-media promotion of the book, but who are also interested in how a book like this actually deals with a social problem, with poverty, with marginalization, with homeless minors. But of course, I'm very interested in what colleagues are writing about, but I'm more interested, of course, in the role this book like this is actually playing sort of within the whole narratives, this whole new narrative about being a comedian. Now, Lisa Friedman said something quite interesting, and I just have to move my own window because it's over the text for me. So she's saying, it's sort of, she contextualizes the book, recent Japanese popular culture depictions of others that ascend homelessness, which turn pressing issue into a personal lesson on how to overcome adversity. And I think this is, although Alyssa Friedman isn't necessarily interested in the comedy side of it, this is one important element indeed of the comedy sort of discourse. And the book is kind of written from the point of view, giving an explanation, why did he choose to become a comedian? And it sort of ends on that note, that he makes that choice, that he's entering this comedy school, NSC comedy school of Yoshimoto Kogyo, and that he's sort of starting to do manzai with his manzai partner, Kawashima Akira. The book is sort of talking about indeed isolation, homelessness. It's really sort of written as a diary from a young boy. And people have sort of said, well, it actually reads like Tamura writes like a 12-year-old or like a 13-year-old. So it's actually really easy to read. And in some way, it's sort of, despite being so, separated from his family, being left behind by his father and his mother had died, it's actually quite a sad book. It sort of has this positive outcome saying, I want to become a comedian because through laughter, I can actually bond with my family. My mother will be proud of me if I can make people laugh. So in some way, the whole idea of becoming a comedian is sort of framed as something like oyakoko, sort of paying respect to your parents, or giving back to the kind of love they have given to you. Very different maybe to the past, when saying, if my child would like to become a comedian, parents would be shocked and say, no way, don't do it. Here, Tamura manages to do it, to frame it very differently. And the book then really contributes, of course, to him being not just successful as a manzai comedian, but making a lot of money from the book. And more Tamura is then afterwards really celebrated as this role model in the media because he was very consistent and he overcame all the hardships and sort of turned the hardships into success in the end, gave him motivation to overcome it. And indeed, this isn't something that just started by the book, but this sort of started out in this comedy talk show, Hitoshi Matsumoto no Suberanai Hanashi, which again was a hugely successful TV show. And I think it still is. I haven't checked recently, it's still running, but almost like an evergreen. And it is actually a really simple TV show. So you just have comedians sitting around a table, and then, Matsumoto himself, of course, started out as a manzai comedian, rolling the dice, and then basically the comedians have to tell an episode, something that happened to them, and the point kind of is, that's the story that can make the listeners laugh or not. Is it the Suburanai Hanashi or not? And the show is interesting because everything these comedians tell is sort of introduced as poor truth. There's sort of this line at the beginning, subete jitsuwa de aru, all of this is really true. There's no disclaimer saying, this is all fiction and it's nothing like that. It's quite the opposite. This is factual, they're telling us. Which of course we can treat we can be skeptic about that because ultimately, of course, this show is meant to make us laugh. Now just to show you the next clip now, just show you how Tamura is telling the story here of becoming a homeless middle school student. So, I think there's a lot of interesting stuff going on that in some way, he's actually telling, actually he's telling something really terrible when you think about it. But he's telling us, you know, as a story, you know, from the point of view of a comedian, it is a story that's supposed to make people laugh. And of course, it's kind of creating the safe space because he is being a comedian, he's there to make us laugh. So we can probably laugh about it without, you know, feeling guilty about it. I think there's a certain level of, you know, laughing about him. You're saying, you know, we have this element of schadenfreude, kind of happy it's not happening to us, it's happening to poor Tamura. But is he really sort of turning, you know, this own episode, this tragic episode, into a funny one? And then it gets sort of labored, you know, because he still, you know, was able to get out of it. And at the end of the day, he learned to, you know, gambaru, to give his best. And he's then saying, well, at the end of the day, this made me, this helped me to become the person I am. It's kind of turned into something that was good for Tamura to experience. But it also really sort of puts the question in how authentic it actually is. And don't want to go into that as today, but there are actually lots of articles in popular magazines that you know, have former friends of Tamura, and they say, oh, you know, that was probably made up or at least exaggerated for this story here. But nevertheless, he's then approached by the publisher and saying, well, you could write a book about this. This is something people would actually like to read about it. And it has an impact sort of on Tamura's sort of stage persona, because this idea that he is someone who always gives his best or always tries very hard is kind of the threat for the manzai he's then performing, where he's always trying very hard, maybe a little bit too hard, but he's always very ambitious and he always wants to do the best for his career. So I also wanted to quickly share a video of him doing manzai here. So this is Tamura's manzai. And you've seen he's shouting, "Gambaru Itachi, let's try our best." So this really became, you know, almost something like their slogan or something that you could identify with Tamura and with his manzai here. And it really reflects what they've been saying at the beginning. They all said, "Yoku Gambata, you really try your best." And we kind of see that on some level, the persona that is being built up when he's talking about his authentic, you know, his authentic episodes, influences what he's doing on stage. But then sort of really goes, I think it goes in both directions. So his material becomes typical for him, jibun nashi. But then of course that also again then enforces sort of the authenticity of the books or of him talking about his own life. But we don't have enough time to read the whole section here from the book and just sort of with a quick translation. But in some ways, if you see how it's written in the book, it's really almost like, you know, it's very close to what he's been telling in the talk show. So he is also, my father standing there and he's saying, no, yes, you can see this is a real shame, but we cannot enter anymore. And then again, this word, you know, dismissed or kaisan. And then, you know, it's kind of reflecting on, you know, how funny this word actually is to be used. Just go a bit ahead of this. But I mean, what's really interesting then at the end is this idea, you know, thinking about this mother who's already dead at this point. I wanted to become the kind of person my mother would be proud of. I wanted to become a respectable person, a person about whom people would say, you know, Tamura Kyoko, who gave birth to him, was a fantastic woman. But to validate the existence of my mother, I wanted to make sure that we would not be forgotten. I wanted our name to live on in everyone's memories. And then you sort of slip different ideas what you could do, maybe become, you know, an inventor of some kind, but he basically says himself, I'm probably not clever enough for that. And then he finds sort of solution saying, you know, comedy can be the solution to live on forever and basically to make my mother proud here. So suddenly, you know, the career, choosing to become a comedian becomes something very, very positive and something that's framed very differently. Now, when we compare this to fictional accounts of the manzai world, and here we're talking about Shinagawa Hiroshi's manzai gang, and of course about Sparks or Hibana, the characters in these books, they are not identical to the comedians that have written the books. So they have different names and they're recognizable differences in their lives. But nevertheless, of course, we get the idea, you know, to some degree, of course, the comedians writing about comedians, we still get the hint that this must be authentic to some degree. And there is a certain amount of overlap between the characters and the authors, of course. Manzai Gang, this is I think now a book which is a bit forgotten maybe because Shinagawa isn't that popular anymore, I think. But however, this really focused on, you know, the life of being a comedian, not so much on the motivation behind it, but, you know, how do I actually find a manzai partner, and how do we struggle to create material that makes people laugh, and what's our relationship to other comedians, and what's the whole competition business going on. So again, it kind of creates a certain level of authenticity, but it still sort of plays with this idea that all these characters here are a bit shady. So actually in this book, and the two manzai partners actually meet in prison because one of them is, you know, one of them is actually a criminal. The other one got drunk, gets put into the prison cell overnight. So it's also sort of a story, you know, they're quite rough juveniles, and then they sort of turn their life maybe around through manzai and have suddenly give their life a meaning. What is quite interesting that Shinagawa also kind of tried to start a career as a filmmaker. So he shot the adaptations of his own novels, and then he would appear in film festivals, Tuxedo. So I think there was a bit of time when, you know, he would discuss his films in highbrow film magazines. So there was kind of an attempt maybe to shift his image from just being a slightly badass comedian to being, you know, being the slightly intellectual filmmaker. He was even, you know, made jury member at the Tokyo International Film Festival. So there was some interest there from the side of the film industry as well to take him on. As far as I can see, we haven't seen much of Shinagawa in terms of filmmaking anymore. And now finally, let's talk about Matayoshi Naoki, and just look at the image of him here. I think that already tells you a lot about, you know, what kind of image he has. He really has this image of being, you know, bookish and intellectual. And you know, he has admiration for this novelist Dazai Osamu, who lived in the first part of the 20th century. You know, he's a bookworm, he's kind of a loner, so again, he's an outsider. And he's using his comedy also as a vehicle to sort of talk about his love for comedy. So this wasn't something he was hiding away, maybe, you know, being afraid that he would alienate comedy fans as such. But he would be writing short essays about the books he loves in sort of comedy magazines or in the free paper that Yoshimoto Kogi is giving out to his fans. And then from the other side, these book publishers or bookstores would say, well, that's actually great. There's a popular comedian who likes reading. This is how we can get more readers, how we can get more people interested in buying our, you know, highbrow books. So he would appear you know, on posters for bookstores or in campaigns by publishing houses. And he publishes this novel Spark, which gets the Akutagawa Prize, and everyone is really surprised. But I think he had it sort of in the making, saying, you know, I'm now rethinking the identity as a comedian, sort of trying to compare manzai with art, and really saying I'm living this lifestyle as an artist, and I'm kind of suffering maybe because I'm struggling finding the right way of expression, maybe more than just saying, you know, I want to make people laugh. It's maybe not the main topic of his book. We have the main character here in the book is called Tokunaga. He's a young comedian. At the beginning of the book, he's about 20. And we see him getting older over several years. And we get all these autobiographic elements that the readership is by now very familiar with, through other books, through the constant, you know, talking about being a comedian and seeing the struggle on TV. So when Matayoshi is now writing about, you know, the struggle for success and competition and all of that, it's not necessarily a new topic anymore. It's something that at least the Japanese readership is very familiar with. The book is about friendship to a slightly older and more experienced comedian, to a senpai, Kamiya. And the two men, they really sort of click on the level that they say, oh, we actually recognize that we have the same love for manzai as an art, and the same, the same idea about how manzai should work. And ultimately, maybe this is more important for us than being successful. So we have certain, red lines that we don't want to break, just in the interest of being successful. And throughout the book, they sort of, emphasize, or they reconfirm their shared values or their shared ideas about manzai, because all the conversations they're having sort of follow, manzai routines, or trying to experiment with gags and how to make it funny, which maybe makes the book to some degree a bit cumbersome to read in the English translation, because there are a lot of reference, of course, to manzai practices. So in some ways, manzai conversation is brought into a book, and so, these conversations are literature in itself. And there's an interesting reference at the beginning, indeed, not at the beginning, but at the beginning of his career, on his road to becoming a manzai comedian. There's actually a reference to these older comedians, Yumeji Itoshi and Kimi Koishi, because in the book here, you hear that the death of the legendary manzai comedian Yumeji Itoshi, which happened in 2003, so this also sort of contextualizes the whole story. I'd watched him and his brother, who were the Itokoi duo on television ever since I was a kid, and they were an inspiration. And then he's just sort of talking about why he's admiring them. And he's saying, I actually admired them because they were really, the basics of manzai, and they were supremely funny. That's what manzai is all about. And they were not relying on personality as such. We see that both Tokunaga and Kami, they kind of have that as an idea in their heads. Now, what's interesting, if you actually compare the translation by Alison Watts, who I think overall does a great job, is that she's sort of adding these extra information. So if you read the Japanese original, it doesn't actually mention the name of the comedian that has died here at this point. And it doesn't even necessarily say, we have been watching them as children and they inspired us to become comedians. Because this is to some degree a discourse that is probably familiar to Japanese readers. And they might not know Yumeji Itoshi, Kimi Koishi, because maybe they're too young or they're not too familiar enough with the kind of comedy that was popular in the 80s in Osaka. But at least they can kind of see, oh yeah, there was an older comedian, and then this boy wanted to become a comedian from early childhood onwards. What I think is actually very cleverly constructed in the original, that the author Matayoshi, I think, is not only using this here as a mean to show how Tokunaga and Kami are bonding, and I'll show you this on the next slide, but I think he's also bonding with the readers to a certain degree. Because he doesn't give the name Yumeji Itoshi, but he sort of gives hints at who he's talking about. And it's sort of up to the reader to decode it and find out what's going on, and then feel a little bit proud and say, oh, yeah, I've got the same kind of shared memory of Itoshi like Matayoshi. And I remember myself reading the book, reading it in Japanese at the beginning, and then sort of realizing what's going on, being quite chuffed with myself and saying, oh, yeah, there's something I share with Matayoshi. And to some degree, that was the moment when I started to really like this book. Now, on the same day, Tokunaga and Kami have a telephone call, and Tokunaga is calling Kamiya. Kamiya is saying, when you finish, come over, we'll eat, he said. What food do you like most? I assumed he was offering me dinner. Grilled meat, I answered straight. No, what food do you like most? Kamiya repeated. Was he asking me to be realistic about what we could eat at this place? What's your favorite food? That's what I'm asking. Aha, got it. He was doing that Itokoi routine. It's hot pot, Kamiya said, nothing for a while. A crowd of laughing voices resounded in the silence. And this it's hot pot is kind of setting up a very famous routine by Itoshi Koishi. But again, this is something which is added here by the translator. So the original Japanese book kind of just throws it at you and doesn't tell you that this is something Kamiya and Tokunaga are now doing because they both love Itokoishi and they both love this routine. They're going to engage on it. And this is kind of how it goes, hot pot, yes, hot pot. You eat pots, you must have extremely strong teeth. So it's kind of very typical manzai stuff, actually, misunderstanding, taking someone literal. Then, you know, all of a sudden, Kamiya was playing the flute here. Now, some of you might remember the scene from the Netflix adaptation. And the Netflix adaptation, again, of course, you know, when you do something on the television, it has to be a bit different. But of course, Netflix also being automatically something that is shared with international audiences at the same time, they actually show you the routine. They sort of show you in a very beautiful scene, I think. I mean, the boy actually listening, you know, watching the television, you get this beautiful shot, you know, almost like from the comedian's point of view, outside of the television, and the audience are watching them. And we get this scene, you know, where the boy watches it and laughs it and sees how the parents and the sisters laughing. And then he's running out and he's actually meeting another boy, and they're sort of starting to do this very routine. So it's very easy on the Netflix show to understand then the following conversation with Kamiya and Tokunaga. Why are they talking about, you know, eating pot? What does that mean? Making it much easier, but it's more difficult to get it on the book, I think. In some ways, maybe I'm still not sure if that's the right way to use, but what they really do is sort of discuss manzai from an aesthetic point of view. So they share ideas, you know, what is funny, what should you do, what should not be doing. Kamiya is sort of emphasizing that, you know, Tokunaga has great potential because he could talk about his poor upbringing and episodes from his childhood. So there's a bit of reference to this, you know, whole authenticity idea. And if you talk about hardships, you know, maybe this is something you can use in your material. And there are just a number of sort of things that come with it, you know, play something from the soul. I hate those who try to please everybody. So, you know, I mean, maybe the audience isn't really, we shouldn't be looking too much at the audience, what they kind of want. And in some way, this is sort of the idea probably also of an artist doing the kind of art you want to do, but you still have to sell your stuff. And we see in both men that they kind of signed up to the idea they want to perform the kind of manzai they do, but they also want to be successful. I think Tokunaga, the narrator, he's the one who kind of, you know, compromises to a certain degree because he wants to be successful, but he really admires Kamiya because Kamiya seems to be the one who is constantly sticking to his values and is motivated to just do good manzai. At the end, the duo of the eye narrator, they sort of have a phase where they're relatively successful, you know, but, you know, they don't have a big break. They're not going to be rich through manzai. So they kind of, you know, give up in the end and they split up. And they have a last show, which becomes very emotional because then it's the time when actually all their friends are coming together. And it just seems to be the show of their life, which is interesting because at that point, when they're suddenly free of this pressure to perform, because they're splitting up, it doesn't really matter anymore if the audience likes them or not. In that moment, suddenly, you know, they seem to be fantastic and they seem to be much better than they used to be. And again, Matayoshi is discussing, you know, the role of the comedian, for example, with haiku poets, and he's comparing, you know, inspiration of the haiku poets, you know, writing down a poem out of, you know, certain emotions that he or she is experiencing, also with his art of writing manzai and of performing manzai. At the end, there's a bit of, you know, the idea, you know, obviously Tokunaga is, maybe he's given up on some of his principles. It also becomes obvious that actually Kamiya is sort of really struggling, you know, is really struggling, sticking to his ideas. And we see that he actually wants to be successful as well, that not being successful, that not getting the reaction he's hoping for, is actually at the end really destroying his life. And I don't want to spoil the ending to you. But you see, all of that doesn't make the book a funny read at all. It's rather serious, and we see a lot of suffering, which in some way is a good message, because of course there's this idea, you know, suffering causes good art, and if dedication makes you suffering, that is maybe the aspect of it that makes you a good artist. Okay, so just some conclusions, and this is something I want to write more about in the book. At some point, so I'm still thinking, where do I want to really emphasize the conclusions? But I think Hibana is a fantastic example of a book that probably works so well in Japan, because this whole system of communication and information in Japan is already there, and people have the necessary background knowledge. And then you can adapt it for all kinds of different media. And looking at adaptation and translation in that concept is very interesting. Hibana is maybe the prime of this image change, because now suddenly we have an artist who is an intellectual and gets prizes. And he's not only getting prizes, but also getting a lot of money for what he does. So, you know, it's really the shift from an outsider to a role model. And even sort of the opportunity saying, you know, you might be a bookish outsider in school, but, you know, make something out of yourself. You can be successful. And with Matayoshi benefiting from questions about, you know, comedy life being discussed earlier by other authors and on television, I think Matayoshi here really gets the space that he needs to discuss manzai from the point of view of an artist, and writing something that is then interesting also for his readers. Okay, I think I would like to stop here. Just if you're interested, maybe not in watching the whole Hibana on Netflix, but maybe if you just want to watch the scene with Itoshi Koishi, because it is a beautiful scene. I would like to share it, but yeah, sort of out of time. It's in episode 4, and it sort of starts around minute 25 of episode 4, and goes on for 10 minutes. Then you can see you can see not just Hibana, but you can also see Itoshi Koishi, which are, of course, in my opinion, the greatest manzai people of all time. Okay, then thank you very much. And I'm very happy to answer any questions or
thank you very much, Till.
Or hearing what you think of Hibana, if you have read it or if you've watched the Netflix show.
Sadly, haven't watched or seen read the book or watched the show yet, but certainly I will look at it now. You've inspired me to have a go and to try it and see what it's like. I was talking to colleagues earlier about this talk and saying that manzai in Japan quite often completely goes over my head, and I think it's because I just don't get a lot of the references because I wasn't brought up in the same, the culture that they are, all the common references that comedians pick up on and that they share. And it seemed from what you're saying as though Matayoshi is doing that in the book as well, with so it's actually the book is very much reflecting the art of the manzai.
Absolutely, yeah,
and Rakugo does the same thing, I suppose, especially the intro bits.
Yeah, increasingly more. I think Rakugo, I mean, if you have sort of orthodox Rakugo, it's probably supposed to do this a little bit less and really focus on the story.
Mm.
But I think the popularity of comedy altogether had an impact on Rakugo as well. And I think many young Rakugo comedians sort of do similar things nowadays. And they have these kind of in-jokes, and that's also how they try to, you know, pull in different Rakugo audiences.
Mm.
But, you know, that might not be something the more, you know, the more, don't want to say old, but, you know, the more orthodox Rakugo fans, they might not enjoy that kind of thing. That's really another discussion.
But that kind of leads us on to one of the questions that Norio Suzuki has put in the chat, which is, you know, is that, can you describe the difference in the way comedians make people laugh in between Japan, UK and Germany? Are there differences that you can pinpoint to what makes people laugh or what comedians do to make you laugh?
This is interesting because as you said at the beginning, when I lived in Manchester, I had already, you know, spent some time researching Japanese comedy. And of course I was always just comparing it to maybe my ideas about German comedy and maybe to English comedy, to the degree that I was aware of English comedy. I could get, DVDs of, well, everyone knows that Germans love Mr. Bean, so I had my Mr. Bean DVDs, and I had my Monty Python DVDs. But only after living in England, then, of course, I became aware that, of course, in English comedy, there's quite a lot of that going on as well. Comedians, they go on panel shows, and they talk about it. And, you know, we have comedians in England as well that kind of play, maybe with the idea that they're not very good as comedians, or that they're talking, you know, about their life at home. So I think that there are actually these parallels between the UK and Japan, maybe more than between Germany and Japan, which is kind of funny in itself, because sometimes I start talks saying, you know, I'm from Germany and I'm researching Japanese comedy, and then people think, haha, obviously that must be a joke in itself. I think the jokes themselves, but let me put it like this. When my book came out in German, and my book has, you know, it's full of examples of where I'm trying to explain why certain manzai jokes are funny, I got a German reviewer who was saying, well, actually, you know, why did you even write that book? They laugh about the same kind of stuff that everyone else laughs about. Mm. And, you know, of course, I didn't necessarily write the book because I wanted to show that, you know, Japanese humor is so exotic and so different. But I think we really get sort of this different, and again, I'm saying sort of framing and sort of, you know, routines and patterns on the stage. And I think manzai here really had a huge impact, that you really have this idea, not just of the foolish comedian, the bokke. And, you know, of course we have sort of, you know, we have Abbott and Costello, and we have comedy leaders in the UK, and maybe some of them sort of plays this sort of more serious role. But there's a certain Japanese way also to how to react to something foolish the other comedian says. And, you know, you might get a little slap, and there's certain, you know, patterns of reacting, and you say something like, nande yanen, and very often the audience in Japan is really enjoying this tsukomi, this reaction, much more than the actual bokke. It's really sort of essential part of what makes it funny, to the degree that we see solo comedians who kind of do, there's this whole sort of subgenre of reaction gay. So they sort of set up something that is funny, but they sort of play then the role of the person who's reacting to it and who's then, you know, commenting on, you know, the absurdity, you know, of an object they find or something like that. And I think this is something which, well, I mean, I don't necessarily know about some other Asian cultures, but I think this is something which I personally find very, you know, very unique, to Japan, this emphasis on, you know, the straight person, not just setting up the punchline as a conversation partner, but then really playing an essential role in, you know, for the timing, making people laugh. And again, this is something which Kamiya and Tokunaga do constantly in the book when they have their conversation. But it's, you know, it's probably something where, as a reader, you know, once you're not familiar with it, it's, you know, it's not easy to read, and maybe don't get the signs, you know, when are they actually switching in this kind of manzai conversation mode.
I mean, you mentioned at the very beginning that, is it 90% of manzai comedians are men? Is it? Why do you think that is? I mean, do you think that's to do again with the style of comedy? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't really done any recent sort of statistical, but I think, you know, if you watch a comedy show, you maybe get one female. So I think on the M1 Grand Prix, I think there were three female doers that participated over all of 15, 16 years or so in the final. I mean, there's a whole can of worms that we could open if we wanted to, that there are people who just say, you know, there's something about men and women that the men are always trying to be funny and they try to impress the women. And I'm not sure if that is essentially true. I think there are many, you know, women who want to be funny and who can be very, very funny. I think there's something, again, in terms of the whole setup, that makes it much harder for women to maybe survive. I mean, there's a certain level of, you know, when you go to these comedy theaters, there's just one changing room, and, you know, everyone is, you know, drinking, and there's probably a certain level of, you know, even sexual harassment, but just making, you know, stupid jokes and then saying, oh no, we're just funny, because it's also sort of part that the older comedians, they're kind of supposed to, you know, be a bit mean to the younger comedians. And then, of course, very soon, the female comedians, they will sort of get them, you know, they will be made fun of just for being women. There was once a very interesting discussion on QI, actually, which when I was teaching about comedy in Manchester, we watched a clip from QI where they were talking about this. And sort of, again, of course, not about the Japanese case, but about the English case. And I think Stephen Fry was saying, you know, many female comedians, being a woman is then their material. They're kind of more limited in their scope because they have to talk about, you know, experience they have as a woman. And I think many of the female comedians in Japan as well are then kind of limited to talking about, you know, all kind of stuff that's kind of seen as being more female than, you know, male topics. So they will talk about, you know, oh, I need a boyfriend, or I want to go shopping, and, you know, all the cliche things. And if they try to talk about something else, it might not work as well. And I think the most successful female comedians, at least 10 years ago, and I haven't been watching so much recently, they were unfortunately the ones that were, I would say, you know, kind of problematic in the sense that they were kind of, you know, always making news of, you know, being mistreated as women. And, you know, saying, yes, of course, do sexual jokes about us, and, you know, that's great for us to stage our persona, and then we can react to it in a way, and we can pretend that we are angry about you, but at the end of the day, it's just very, very funny. You know, if I'm angry, if you're mean to me.
Interesting. There's a question in the chat again from Leo Capella asking, saying, it's a really interesting talk. Does manzai still have a place for outsiders now that it's become so respectable? And if so, what groups are they coming from? What kind of outsider groups? Are there any new ones?
I mean, I think it still has maybe even more potential for outsider groups because it suddenly offers the perspective. You know, it suddenly offers the perspective saying, you know, manzai isn't just maybe a mean to you know, make just enough money to buy your dinner, which it might have been, you know, in the past for comedians. But I think for some comedians, it's, and this is then again something they would talk about in their routines and in their interviews, it's something like maybe their last chance almost to make something out of their life. So when I was doing my manzai, we were also part of, you know, not of Yoshimoto, the second largest agency in Osaka, and there were loads of, you know, there were loads of other comedians, and they were saying interest, you know, they weren't really funny behind the stage because they had to save all their material for comedy, and then they said something interesting to my manzai partner, and you know, we met in the Rakugo Club of Kansai University, which is a big private university in Osaka. You know, it's not necessarily an elite university, but it's, you know, it's a decent private university. And they were all saying to him, why are you even here? You are, you know, you are at Kansai University. You could have all kind of other jobs. You know, you could have a decent job. But the other comedians, oh, they were thinking of themselves as having no other opportunities.
Anymore. Okay, yeah.
So I think there's actually increasingly this idea, you know, even if I'm, you know, and again, I don't really like to use these terms, but if people feel of themselves as maybe being a failure to some degree, not being good in school, and, you know, maybe not wanting to work on some level, then comedy could be the space, you know, where I can gain respect. And there's this whole story about, you know, people saying I'm a comedian and I'm a professional comedian, which I think many comedians say with a lot of pride, but it doesn't mean that they make a lot of money. Mm-hmm. There are loads of comedians who are relatively well known, at least sort of in local television programs in Osaka, but they still go and work, you know, part time at the cash register in the convenience store to make extra money.
And this probably, I mean, kind of leading on a bit from this outsider side of things, but probably betrays my ignorance, but again, in the clips that you showed, it was very Kansai accent, Kansai dialect. And is there non-Kansai dialect manzai? Does it exist? And if so, what other kind of speech patterns do people go for?
I mean, this is a very fascinating question. And I think it's something where someone, I'm not sure if I will do this because I'm not a linguist, but this is something where I would say a linguist one day has to do a research on exactly that. So there is. But there's no doubt that manzai is, you know, a very Kansai-ish thing, a very Osaka-ish thing. So of course, manzai, or, you know, the modern form of manzai, as we know it now, started to become popular in Osaka, and many of the famous, not just manzai comedians, but all many famous comedians are from Kansai. And people actually say, you know, in some way, this, you know, this whole tsukomi boke thing is something which reflects the way people in Osaka speak anyway, you know. And people in Osaka, you know, they kind of say, yeah, I'm more of a tsukomi, and I'm more of a boke. So this kind of these role patterns are very close to the way people in Osaka like to communicate. But again, there's a little bit of, you know, also, you know, maybe making the people in Osaka more exotic than they are, because of course not everyone in Osaka, sorry if there's anyone here from Osaka for saying so, not everyone in Osaka is terribly funny, and not everyone necessarily talks in that way anyway. But I think the popularity of manzai in Osaka, and then manzai from Osaka all across the country, and again, the huge influence of this big comedy agency, Yoshimoto Kogyo, who set up these comedy schools you know, all across in Tokyo, and who are, again, I haven't really, you know, done any quantitative research on that, but maybe, I don't know, maybe 80% of the comedians on Japanese television belong to Yoshimoto Kogyo. They all sort of go to some degree through this comedy school, and there you kind of are being, you know, pushed in it. At the beginning, at least finding a partner, and then, you know, because you only have 3 minutes to audition within the comedy school, you also automatically are pushed to maybe do, you know, manzai and to set up, you know, the stage for a proper sketch. So I think automatically people adapt this style, having boke and tsukomi, and we have of course doers from Tokyo maybe in the 80s that have still quite different style, and I think the manzai that's maybe still performed more in the Yose theaters in Tokyo is still quite different, I think. Mm. It's more the boke talking much more in a monologue, and it's going to be just saying, I see. I think on television, it would be also because that really has taken over, up to the degree that certain you know, phrases like nandiyanen, which means something like, what are you talking about? It's sort of, you know, almost like, you know, if you write a book about Osaka dialect, you might want to call it nandiyanen. Is something which also the Tokyo comedians will now sometimes just use to shout at their manzai partners.
Sorry, moving on. There's another question in the chat from Richard Talbot. Hibana via Netflix appears to really emphasize the senpai kohai loyalties. For example, Kamiya and Tokunaga don't start working together officially, and Tokunaga's career ends when his partner stops work. Is there a fluidity between the duos, or in other forms? Or if, for example, moving into sketch TV, is that uncommon?
Maybe they could specify a bit what fluidity between duos means.
Richard, again, do you want to unmute yourself and speak and explain your question a bit more?
Sorry, it's not very clear. What I mean is that there's examples of comedians in the UK working in sketch groups or working on TV programs in different combinations, and I don't think we're so aware of the loyalties. Maybe you could say in the UK there's lots of comedy duos and brands, and people do stick to those, so it's not necessarily different. But I just wondered how much fluidity there is commercially, okay. I suppose, within.
Yeah.
Okay, and is it affected by this senpai kohai relationship? I don't know.
Okay, I think I get the question now. I'm better. Thank you for clarifying. So normally when a duo splits up nowadays, I mean, I can't think of a case in recent manzai histories. There are cases sort of early on before the war where actually the agencies would sort of even go on regrouping comedy duos. I can't think of a recent example for manzai duo that at least sort of reached a certain stage of popularity, of being, you know, well-known enough that people would recognize them, where after splitting up, one of them then would form, you know, a new partnership and would form a new duo. Some comedians then sort of continue their careers as solo comedians. There are actually recently a few examples where comedians have become rakugo storytellers and ended their apprenticeship with a rakugo comedian. But very often they kind of keep they keep the name of their duo almost like something like a brand name to some degree. And then even if they appear somewhere alone by themselves, and this sometimes it's not even the case that they split up, sometimes it's just the case that one of them for some reason is more popular than the other, because they do appear in other genres, and they do appear in these talk shows, for example. So I think Tamura is a good example that at the beginning when Kirin came out, I think the other guy was a bit more popular because he's a bit more, you know, he has a star, deep voice, and he's, you know, quite interesting looking. And Tamura, you know, seemed a bit, you know, didn't seem that interesting. But of course, once Tamura had this book out, he was always, you know, on talk shows by himself. And the other one, can't think of his name right now. The other one just, you know, almost fell off the bandwagon to some degree. But nevertheless, Tamura would always be sort of introduced as Kirin Tamura. So almost like, and I mean, the duo name doesn't really become their stage name as such. So it's not like it replaces his surname, but it would always, you know, be there in the screen when they have the Teda Pro, when they have the name, you know, written on the screen, it would also say Kirin Tamura Hiroshi. So in that sense, even probably forming a new duo would be quite harmful. Even for their branding, yeah.
Okay. But
it's an interesting question. I'd be interested to see.
Thank you very much, Till, for answering so many questions and for, you know, sharing your expertise over a good, well over an hour. Thank you.